My name is Joe Dalton, entrepreneur and business coach. Welcome to Breakthrough Brands. Each week we bring you an inspirational story and an insight to the minds of some of the top business leaders, authors and mentors from around the globe. Whatever is needed to make you shine in life and business, you'll find it here.
On this week's show, we have Declan Coyle. Declan is director of Andec, author of The Green Platform, and one of Ireland's most internationally experienced leadership training and development consultants. He is also much sought after as a conference keynote speaker. His success as a top-class inspirational speaker for business leaders has in recent years been harnessed in the sports arena, where he has given regular goal-setting and mental strength motivational sessions to a number of All-Ireland Club Championship teams. He regularly addresses and inspires senior management teams and CEOs in companies across the globe.
If you wish to reach me about any of the topics covered in this episode or any other episode, you can get me on WhatsApp 086-821-0037 or email joe@jdc.ie or follow me on LinkedIn under Joseph Dalton. I also need your help to spread the word. If you could please take 2 minutes to share, like, or make a comment on this episode, I would be truly grateful. Declan Coyle, welcome to Breakthrough Brands. How are you?
Very good, Joe. It's a great privilege to be here.
You wrote a book called The Green Platform, and the book has changed, I would have to say, thousands and thousands of people's lives around the world. Before I knew you, I've seen the book on shelves in different countries and always wondered what it was. And then through circumstances, we've actually met. But before we get into the book and the values what the book has to someone changing their lives, tell me your story.
Well, Joe, I had a very privileged upbringing. I grew up in a place called Dungimmon, which I would describe as paradise on earth. It's on between Loch Crew and Loch Sheelan, the holy mountain of Loch Crew, Slieve na Gaeilge, and the romantic lake of Loch Sheelan, forever linked to the love story of Orwin and Sabina. And in that valley there, we had our farm. We're just lucky enough to be inside Cavan. So in our tribe, we give thanks to God every morning that we're born in Cavan. So,
shocking.
So growing up on a farm, it was in the 50s, 60s, horses, cattle, sheep, pigs and all of that. And there was a thing in the neighbourhood. My father had this thing. If a man had a cow calving or hay down, he'd say, we'll go out and give that man a hand. That was the thinking. And when I was 16, I read an article in a Columban mission magazine called The Far East about a missionary priest in a slum outside of Lima in Peru called El Montan, and he had 40,000 slum dwellers. So I simply said, sure, if I go out and give that man a hand, he'll only have 20,000. It was that simple. Yeah. So I joined the Columbans in Dalgan Park, Navan, and that meant emigrating into Meath, which I did. And then at 1969 was ordained. Instead of getting out to a slum in the Philippines or Latin America, I was sent to Ottawa to do postgraduate studies. Then appointed to teach in Boston after that, but I wrote to the Superior General and I said, I've had 9 years of post-secondary school study. My problem is that I think that I know it all. But if you give me 5 years in the slum in the Philippines or Latin America, where the slum dwellers have been to the University of Life and survived, and they teach me, and I get this in my blood and my guts and my bones, then I'll teach anywhere. But at the moment, I have just a head full of academic knowledge and I'll perpetuate the system that I don't really believe in. So instantly I got a letter back, you're assigned to a slum in the Philippines for 5 years. And so we say in Dungimmon, that softened my cough.
That was it, yeah. Was that the time Mel de Marcus was?
Yeah. There was Ferdinand Marcus was the dictator, Imelda was his wife, and she of the
shoes
3,000 yeah. pairs of shoes, one pair that would feed a barrio for a month.
Yeah.
But in the last 90 days, I buried 65 children under 2 years old, all who died from hunger or hunger-related diseases. To combat that, I set up feeding programs and pig projects, hen projects, cooperatives, credit unions, grameen banks, all of that. But after the 5 years, a Jesuit from, he was from the Bronx in New York, Father Dennis Murphy, he did a debrief with me. And typical Jesuit, he praised me for all the work I'd done, you know, and built me up, and I was purring like a cat. And then he had the key question, Joe, the life changer. He said, over the past 5 years, are you a happier, more creative, more joyful, more innovative person? Or are you more angry and bitter and resentful? And Joe, justification is an awful word, because instantly I snapped and I said, Dennis, did you hear a single thing I said? I just told you I buried 65 children who died from hunger in a world full of food. Of course I'm more angry and bitter and resentful. And he said to me, if you're coming back to this slum, bring the people joy or bring them nothing, because the last thing they need is another long-faced, miserable worker for justice and peace with your serious face. He said, the end must be prefigured in the means. You must live the utopia you're talking about. All your projects are merely a container. The contents are your inner peace and joy. And if I want a Mercedes-Benz from you, you cannot give it to me because you haven't got it. But if I want peace or joy from you, you still cannot give it to me because you haven't got it. And he said, you come from an angry generation, and an angry generation cannot bring peace and joy to this world. He said, you still don't get the Gandhi thing, do you? I says, what do you mean the Gandhi thing? Be the change you want to see in the world. If you are the change you want to see in the world, he said, God help the world. So
be the change. That's what I say. Did that resonate with you at that time?
Well, it brought me back then to when I was doing my postgraduate studies in Ottawa, to an extraordinary man I met there, a man called Viktor Frankl, an Austrian psychiatrist. He was our visiting professor. He was tortured in Auschwitz during the Second World War. And he told me, they tortured me, they broke my body, they did operations on my genitals. But he said they couldn't touch my spirit. And there I discovered the last and the greatest of the human freedoms, to choose my response in any given set of circumstances. So he said, I'm not responsible for other people's actions, but I'm totally responsible for my reactions. I'm not responsible for what happens to me, but I'm totally responsible for what I do about what happens to me. And he radically changed, like it was like a paradigm shift, because I had grown up in Dungimmon with handed down scripts from the 12th century, 14th century, 16th century, 18th century. And I'd say things to him like, oh, he made me very angry. And he'd say, no, Declan, there you go. Why are you making such a poor choice? Nobody makes you angry. He is doing what he's doing. He's jumping up and down like a horse gone mad. But you are freely choosing to be angry. That is your choice.
Free choice.
Now, I remember resenting that because I was so conditioned. And I tried to explain to him that in Dungimmon, people made us angry. But no, he wasn't having that. And I'd say, drop sentences in like, oh, that one, she really annoys me. He said, no, you are making a very poor choice there. And then he come on, he said, Declan, where is this coming from? Why do not you get it? I said, Victor, you want to know where it's coming from? It's coming from the 12th century, the 14th century, the 16th century. It's coming from my mother. Your mother? Your mother? You blame your mother? You are like the American? You blame your mother? I said, yes. Because there were six of us in the family, five boys, one girl. We were in the corner of the room and we're messing, carrying on. And my mother would come in and she'd say, now stop that, carry on, you're making me very angry. It never occurred to me to say, excuse me, mammy, but of all the choices you're making, that's probably one of the poorest ones now in terms of your life quality for today. And because in our house, you weren't even allowed back answer. So they were the two seminal things that number one, to be happy, to be joyful. And number two, that it's a choice I can make every day. Because growing up in Dungimmon, the outer weather, we had bad days, good days. We felt you could do nothing about it, and we're right. We also felt that our inner weather, we thought we could do nothing about it. But Victor and Dennis taught me, you can do everything about your inner weather.
So you were in the Philippines. You realised then from teachings that you had in America, when did you kind of go, okay, I need to take that different direction? I need to try and reach people in a different way.
Well, it came after the Philippines. I was 4 years back here doing education work about what we called then third world debt and the unjust trade and all of that. And then I was assigned to Taiwan and I worked in a slum there for 6 years. just speaking Chinese. Then 1990, I got married to Annette. She's Australian. And we set up our own company, Andec Communications. And I looked around and I saw in the corporate world the same kind of sadness and misery I saw in the slums. And I realised that it doesn't matter whether you're in a slum or in a boardroom, people were still missing this joy, this happiness. And they all expected that something outside them would bring them happiness. None of them realised that they could choose it. So it came that I used to be against positive thinking, Joe, because I thought it was an American aberration, in the sense that I thought in America they're all positive, but they're not
have
real.
Have a good day.
Yeah.
Falseness.
But in Ireland, we're all negative, but we're real. But beneath that, that was only surface stuff. Beneath that was the idea that why I was against positive thinking was that if I had a major tragedy, if my three children were killed, and you know, you come along and you say, oh, you got to have a PMA, you got to have a positive mental attitude, you got to get on the positive green platform. I'll give you a PMA and the positive green platform because you must be emotionally honest. You cannot pour pink positive paint over human suffering. You honour the feeling. You cry the tears. That's not being negative.
People will say, oh, you have to be positive and you know, have that great attitude. But it's deeper than that. It's deeper. They're only words.
Yeah. It's much deeper because it's about being real. It's about being authentic. It's about being valid. And then we have our white space, where we have the last and the greatest of the human freedoms. And after I've felt it, after I've honoured it, my human experience, then I have a choice. And I can choose a red platform, which is the victim, the whinge, the whine, the moan, the poor me. And I call it a platform because underneath that platform is a septic tank of sabotage called fear. False evidence appearing real. And on that red platform, we have the ego, the false self. And it has an agenda to keep us from our happiness now. It's very good at doing that. It gets us into the past with shame or guilt or regret, or into the future with fear, anxiety or worry. But like a shadow cannot live in sunshine, the ego cannot live in the now. So if we bring awareness to the present moment and awareness to the choice I can make, I can get into my white space and I can choose the green platform with the 10 most powerful words in the English language, no word more than two letters. If it is to be, it is up to me. Underneath the green platform is the field of all possibility. It's where I choose joy, where I choose creativity, where I choose innovation, where I choose to act out of a vision for my life. I act out of a template for the future, and I don't keep on repeating the familiar past on the red platform. Rather, I create the future on the green platform.
Okay, so what we're saying is green is living true to yourself, being passionate in everything you do and learning to have an inner peace and looking at everything positive. The red is the negative. I can't do it. I won't do it. All that negativity is the red. And the white is the inner gap between both. I'm just explaining for our audience.
Yeah. The white space is you have the event, first of all. It's the trigger. Something happens. And then I feel it, I'm emotionally honest, but then I have that round white space and there I can choose my response. I can say, this is a disaster, or I can say it's a great opportunity.
Like myself, you were probably bungling these around in your head, these thoughts. And when did you kind of go, traffic lights? Aha.
Yeah, it was a sentence Robert Holden used one time in one of the present, and I was drawing to keep listening to him, and I was drawing any images he came. And he said at one stage, the quality of your life depends on which platform you choose to land on, positive or negative. And I had drawn two platforms, positive, negative, and little man, and one happy man and a miserable man. And I was driving home, and at the traffic lights, I said, subliminally, red for stop, green for go. And green had also the whole idea of new life, spring, freshness, growth, development,
yeah,
creativity. All of that was in the whole green. And I knew to go international, And I wanted something to come out of Ireland that was life-changing, that was life-transforming. So the Green Platform, coming out of the Green Island, the Emerald Isle, that would also connect with a whole green world of taking care of our environment and looking after the world.
So we know that the majority of people are living in the red zone, okay, the red platform. And a lot of them, it's ingrained into them subconsciously from being a child. You know, you can't have that. Money doesn't grow on trees. All that negativity that we all learn to talk, which just comes part of our speech. And that can be from our parents or our grandparents or a grade. It's led up through the generations. How are people developing themselves to get into that green? Is it a journey they're going on? Will people live in the red and die in the red? And only a certain amount of people will find the green?
Well, it's my experience that, and I said at the end of the book, that some people say it'd be very difficult to live on the green platform all the time. But we all know thousands of people, you can name them, who lived in it without ever being aware of it, who were on it, who lived on it. You have the Nelson Mandelas, you have the, you know, the Martin Luther Kings, but you have your own neighbours at home. You have maybe your own mother. You have people like that who are consistently positive, uplifting. You have a conversation with them and you feel better than before. The conditioning is there. On an average day, we have 50,000 thoughts. Some of the neuroscientists say it's up to 80,000. But what they agree on is that 80% of those thoughts are negative. And it's that conditioning we've got, because the subconscious that controls 96% of the way we act and move and have our being will not process a negative. So if I say to you, Joe, don't think of a white rabbit, bang, the white rabbit is there. A mother will say to a child, be careful, don't drop that. The child will drop it. Oh, I could see it coming and you knew it's going to happen. You don't listen to me. The problem is the child listened. So if you look at ordinary life, and where I grew up in Dungiven, we gave ourselves auto-suggestions to feel miserable. Remember, the subconscious won't process not. So we'd say, we suffered from a disease, and our disease was called not-so-badism. How are you doing? Not so bad. The subconscious won't process not bad. Hanging in there, surviving, keeping head over water. Can't complain. And I got one down in Clare. Two steps ahead of the hares.
Yeah.
And another one up in Oma. Or sitting up and eating a bit, the hospital bed one. And one man from Cork said, I went up the West and it drove them crazy. What do you mean you drove them crazy? I went counterculturally, he said. I said, what do you mean you went counterculturally? He says, I went all positive. You went all positive.
Yeah,
he says, I discovered psychosomatically, you cannot say great and feel bad.
Yeah.
So that's the...
It's interesting, because just when you're talking about the children, and there was something in the book that you said with my own kids, it's saying to them, instead of saying, you're naughty,
yeah,
you know, you're going, you're a great kid. Will you pick that up?
Yeah.
And it's that subliminal messaging, is it to create them? And, you know, and I've said this before, that I have my 7-year-old, I ask her, what are you? And she goes, Daddy, I'm your happy, healthy, wealthy little girl. And I drive that into her all the time, because I know that's going to feed into her subconscious mind. So when she's in her 20s and her 30s, she'll always remember, I'm happy, I'm healthy. And now I'm throwing wealthy into it as well for her, because I don't want her to go through those worrying stages that we all went through when we were kids, because it was our own parents that had an issue. Like, my mother lived in a 2-bedroom place with 7 kids and a mother and father, and same with my father. So they grew up in that small financial risk in the city centre. And I'm trying to teach my children that life is amazing. I feel that I found the way we do things and the way the mind works and the way that the energy flows, and I'm excited about it. But it's not new. People have discovered this 100 years ago, people 200 years ago, 5,000 years ago. But every time when you find it in every generation, you go, brilliant, you think it's new, but it's not. It's always been there. Why has it been depressed? Did the teachings stop people, to teach them to be positive, to realise that your thoughts control everything, and if you do this, your life can change and all your surroundings can change? Where did it go wrong in the centuries to kind of go, oh no, we're going to keep everyone down?
Well, I think it came from, again, your last sentence there, it was a lot about power and control, and a lot of it was to do with the wars and who's right and who's wrong. And it was that dualism of I'm right, you're wrong. And we had even religion. We had 100 fingers pointing at the moon. If the moon is God, on each finger saying minus the correct finger and missing the moon. So we had all of that over the years. But when you go through famines and wars and all of that where survival is at stake, then that inner peace, that inner joy can be lost. And that's why we owe a huge debt of gratitude to the monks of the West and the East who maintained this and showed us how to respond with compassion to everything. But it's very often the breakthroughs come in small things. Like, it's one thing, we all know what to do, but doing what we know is the big gap. Even though Viktor Frankl told me that way back in the 70s, it wasn't Genevieve, our eldest daughter, when I was 25. 21 years ago, when she was 4, was the first time I actually put this into practice, lived it, because I'd known it intellectually. Well, there's a massive difference between knowing it intellectually and being transformed so that you live it. Because we have people with 3 PhDs, but they're not transformed. They don't have transformation. We have people to go to mass, 1,000 masses, and they'll still cut you out of it at the car park. We have people who have all this knowledge but are not transformed. A simple thing, when Genevieve was 4, I was putting eggs in the fridge. And she said, Daddy, I want to help you put the eggs in the fridge. I said, no, Genevieve, they're very delicate, they're very fragile, I'll put them in myself. And she said, no, Daddy, please, 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 I want to help you. I said, okay, well, be careful, just don't drop them. So on cue, she dropped the two of them. And I was about to react on Red Platform, and I was downloading all that parental muck from the time we were cavemen and cavewomen. And I could feel it all. And at the last second, I saw my white space, and I saw a little green platform the size of a postage stamp, and I managed to get on it. And I said, Genevieve, isn't that a very interesting design on the floor? Do you think she would take a photograph of that and show it to Mammy? And she was so stunned, Joe. She caught my leg, little face looked up, and she says, Daddy, I love you.
Yeah, lovely.
But that was the first time in my life I was conscious of making a choice, of choosing my response. So something happens, and a fact has no meaning, a situation has no meaning, an event has no meaning, unless I make up a story about it. So it's my story, my meaning, my interpretation. It's not my experience, but how I internalize and experience my experience that matters. So something happens, I can say, woe is me on the red platform, or I can say, I can handle it on the green platform. And it's the same with questions. On the red platform, we ask poison questions. It's 100% certain you'll get poison answers. What are red platform poison questions? They're, why me? What else is going to go wrong? What did I do to deserve this? Why do these things always have to happen to me? 100% certain you'll get a poison answer. Why you? Because you're a slob. Because you lacked early life love. Because your mother loved your sister more than you. But I didn't have a sister, but if you had, you would have. So we're going to get a poison answer to a poison question. But if we switch to the green platform and ask power questions, how can I, what can I? How can I turn this around and enjoy the process? How can we have more fun around here? How can we double our productivity and have our time? How can I be the very best version of myself so that those around me can flourish and shine and be the best that they can be? How can I put all kinds of a positive self-image into my daughter's head so that when she grows up, when we look at the average child at 4 self-image, 98% of children have a massive, great, positive self-image. But at 14, 98% have a negative self-image.
Yeah, a child at 2, ask them all to sing and they all go right. And then you ask them at 13, 14 and they don't. So it's external is causing the issues. It's the internal that we're losing, and we should That's be the intuition. What did you say about the Zen monk that you met? You asked him a question and he said, what's the difference between enlightenment and not enlightenment? And it was chopping wood and drawing water.
Yeah.
And you said, what was it after? And he said, chopping wood and drawing water.
It was very simple. I had asked him, I asked him, what's Zen Buddhism? And
okay,
he said, it would take 40 years to teach you Zen Buddhism. And I said, look, I don't, through another Columban missionary, he translated for me in Japan, over in Kyoto. But he said, if you cannot tell me in one sentence, you don't understand it. Oh, he said, I can give it to you in one sentence. It'll still take you 40 years to live it. So I said, okay, give it to me. And he said, you're only doing what you're doing. And I said, what do you mean you're only doing what you're doing? Because I was translating it exactly. And he said, before enlightenment, chopping wood, drawing water. After enlightenment, chopping wood, drawing water. Now, I said, maybe I'm missing something in the translation, but they actually sound exactly similar to me. And he said, no. Totally, utterly, radically different. Before enlightenment, chopping wood, drawing water, but always with that mental noise. Why is it always me that has to chop the wood? There's no one else draw water around me. They can do without water for the tea that for the next week. I'm fed up with this. After enlightenment, I am chopping wood. I am drawing water. I am bringing love from deep within me to what I'm doing. The question, Joe, is that he would, is who are you becoming as a person while you're washing the dishes?
Yeah.
I remember once the lovely Vietnamese monk, Thich Nhat Hanh, and he said one sentence. He was giving a talk to a group in the States, and he said, the challenge is to respond to everything, every moment, with compassion. That, in a sense, nothing gets through your awareness that you don't want to create and attract into your life.
Okay.
We do two things in life. We think and we feel. Now, my question to people is, this is a very precious space and time we have to think and feel. Are you thinking and feeling about what you want to create and attract in your life, into your life on the green platform? Or are you thinking and feeling about what you don't want to create and attract into your life on the red platform? And one man who did it very well, but he worked for 6 weeks to keep his attention what he wanted. He was working in his body to get into a good place after an accident. But every time the thought would come in, I'll end up in a wheelchair, he banished it. And he was able to focus it. But it's though not entertaining those negative thoughts. You know that, is this what I want to create and attract?
But with the negative thoughts, I used to, when I got a negative thought, I used to push it away. And I've learned now with a negative thought, I accept the negative thought and I then smoothly replace it with a positive. Where I used to go, there's a negative thought, get rid of that, and go, life's brilliant, push it through.
Yeah.
But it's not. It's accepting it and letting it sort of, like water, flow through and then knowing to push it in with the green. You start teaching this in companies. You start developing the green platform. You were showing companies how to run a better successful company. And you have some great stats, you know, on that. How did that evolve then into your teachings and your workshops and everything?
Well, when I started working in the whole areas of leadership and management and communication skills, sales and presentation skills and personal development. And as I was working in companies, I saw that, in the early years, I was very, very good at doing strategies and plans and visions and goal setting and all of that. And then over the years, I realized that something that Drucker and Buffett had said years ago is that culture will eat strategy and plans for breakfast. So then I put a lot of work into changing the culture to get that green platform, positive can-do culture. And it had almost an immediate effect in terms of it translated into greater productivity and greater profits. And in Harvard, they did a study on, you know, when people are positive in the present, which is essentially what the green platform is about. But as a result of it, across a whole range of companies, they were 31% more productive and 37% better at sales. Now, the negative side was when a CEO would say to me, oh, this is all touchy-feely stuff. What's got to do with the bottom line? With the bottom line or with... And I said, okay, do you want to know the cost of negativity, red platform, the cost of the red platform to the economy of the United States in the year 2013? He said, but you must have genuine research. I said, okay, the Harvard Business Review, May edition 2014, page 62. And he said, okay, what is it? The cost of the economy in the United States that year was $500 billion. If I have $1,000 bills in my hand 4 inches high, I'm a millionaire. $500 billion is $1,000 bills in my hand 38 miles high. That's from Dublin, $1,000 bills stacked all the way down to Kildare, to Newbridge, to Monstrevin. That is the cost. So negativity, but apart from that, negativity it'll get that old cortisol thing going in your system. It causes stress, it causes disease, it causes all kinds of colds and flus and everything. Whereas if people are positive in the present, it activates the serotonin, the, you know, all the good, happy endorphins, the you know, the dopamine.
You're speaking about this all over the world and you're talking to people. And some of the results you were saying, there was companies that you were out there and they looked at their sales targets, the people that turned up and went to your course, and then you looked at their targets, they were something like 40% greater or whatever.
That's right.
Do you get people when they're in it, you know, as we do when we're running workshops, people that are made go to a workshop and they're sitting there not interested in it, do they kind of go, okay, this guy's talking sense, and you engage with them? And how has that evolved then? Is there companies that keep asking you to come back year on, year on?
Yeah, once people get it, the thing is, they get it, because of the world we're living in, they want top-ups, is what they call it. So you go back and you workshop it. The first time I give them the tools, work on the tools. But after that, it's workshopping it so that they have the tools, and they're giving me examples of how they use it. And even a CEO of a big multi-billion dollar company in California, and he said to me, I'm astonished that something so simple could have such a profound transformational effect on the culture of the company. And he said, even simple things like, I now have a red mat and a green mat, and people would always come into me with problems. And I say, okay, if you have a problem, stand on the red mat and come back to me when you're ready to stand on the green mat with a solution. And had one man came in last week and said, oh, sorry, I'm heading for the wrong mat. I'll be back. You know, so it's an easy way, and it's non-threatening. And people say, I'm on the red platform, I'm on the green platform. And they can see that it's a choice. And what I do, Joe, a thing that has been extremely effective for companies is this. When I ask CEOs, we ask them around the world, what's your single biggest problem? It's not goal setting, it's goal achieving. Second is consistency in that.
Just going to take a short break. Are you looking to boost your performance, motivate your sales team, have an all-round structure to your marketing? Get in touch with myself at Breakthrough Brands or contact me at joe@jdc.ie. Tell me about goal setting.
Well, when we ask CEOs around the world about goals, about what's their single biggest problem, the single number one problem they have is not goal setting. That's easy to do in the boardrooms and colour code them and all of that. But then they leave the boardroom and real life intervenes. So it's not goal setting, their challenge is goal achieving. And the second biggest problem was consistency in that goal achieving, not just the week after the meeting, but consistency. But there was a method that the American Association of Training and Development came up with that we've been using for the last 20 years. And we call it the Green Platform Partnership Program. And that is when people have a partner who will hold them positively accountable to be the best that they can be, implementation zooms from 40% to 95%. It's a 55% increase. And the way we work it is we'd have a 15-minute session on it where I would have my Green Platform partner. And there's five questions. We just run past them. And it's the first one is, was I on the green platform this week? Because creating the green platform, positive, can do, make it happen, solution-oriented culture is number one. So that's the first one. Did I slip off it? How did I get back on it? And this is my partner is someone who will hold me positively accountable to be the best that I can be so that those around me can flourish and shine and be the best that they can be. That's the first question. Second question is, 20% of our activities will give us 80% of results. In the same way that 20% of drivers cause 80% of the accidents, 20% of drinkers drink 80% of the beer, 20% of your home contains 80% of the rubbish, and 20% of our customers will give us 80% of our profit and our income. But 20% of our tasks will give us 80% of our results. So was I focused like a laser beam on the 20% of my tasks that are delivering results, bottom line? That's to say, or was I wallowing in the 80% of busy stuff that's the busy fool, the headless chicken that's nice to do but not delivering results? Third question is, was I working out on my strengths this week? And the reason I ask that is because when we ask people around the world, how are we the company using your strengths? 83% say no. You're not using my strengths. Now, part of this goes back to education, because education has to ask and answer two questions. A ducere, to lead, duco, the Latin word to lead or to draw A from, out from within. What's your gift? What's your talent? What's your signature strength? And A ducere, how are we going to use that in the service of humanity to build a better world? Now, I got 9 years of post-secondary school study, but I never got an education, because no teacher, no professor ever once sat me down and educated me and said, Declan, what's your gift? What's your talent? What's your signature strength? Now, let's see how we can use it in the service of humanity to build a better world. I got edstuffedination, but not education. So when we ask people, again, around the world, how are we, the company, using your gift, your talent, your signature strength, 83% say no. So what are middle managers doing? What are corporate middle managers doing? I'll tell you what they're doing, Joe. They spend the morning, they're very active teaching hens to swim. Yes. But the hen can't swim. So then the afternoon, they build a hen gym and the hen doing all kinds of exercises and still the hen can't swim. And then they bring in a personal trainer. Come on, hen, you can do it. Make it 11, 12 and still the hen is no good. Then they get in 360-degree feedback and say it's not just us, but everyone else is saying you're okay at laying the eggs, but you're not. You have to improve your swimming. The hen goes out from the personal development review depressed and the manager is depressed. And then they find this great guy who's written a book called The Green Platform, and he says, come on, hen, I'm going to work with you. The you you see is the you you'll be. If it is to be, it's up to me. Be positive, think positive, be the very best version of yourself. He's useless. Get rid of him on his green platform. And then one day, then one fine day, we discover a duck and a duck swims. Swimming is a duck's job. Laying eggs is a hen's job. But around the corporate world, we have Mozart milking cows. We have Michelangelo mining sheep. And here in Dublin, we have some of the best carpenters or cabinet makers in Europe working as frustrated surgeons because they had the points. So the third thing is, was I working out of my strength? Was I doing what I love and loving what I do? You asked me the other day, what was the best business advice you ever got? And I asked that to a man, David Hunt, who's CEO of Cantus, a company here in Dublin, a young startup company. And he said he had talked to Dr. Pierce Lyons, and Dr. Pierce Lyons was asking him about what he was doing. And Dr. Lyons said to him, and do you like it? Do you care about it? Do you like it? No, not that much. Then stop doing it, he said. Like, why are you doing it? And he says, that rocked me. He said to me, do what makes your heart sing. Like, you know, connect to your purpose, do what makes your heart sing, but don't die with your music still in you. So that idea of working out of your talent, and when you do what you love and you love what you do, you'll never work another day in your life. So that's the third question. Fourth question is, I always have three what are called figs, fiercely important goals. Because again, when we ask people around the world, what are the three figs, fiercely important goals of your company? 85% haven't a clue. Now, my question to that is, how can you hit a target that you cannot see? It's like you're like a blind archer being turned round and round, now fire. So to get energy, we must have clear goals, we must have clarity. And in the world we're living in now, Joe, getting clarity on those three goals is huge, because we're drowning in a sea of complexity. Mm. We need, when I work with companies, I ask them to appoint a CSO, a Chief Simplification Officer. Stop the complexity. We're killing people with complexity. It is so difficult to get things done. And yes, it should be just very, very simple. That's the fourth one. And then I tag into that one just each morning. What are the five most important things you have to do, the five tasks, and do them first before anything else, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And then the fifth one then is just, it's what I call a monthly rock. It's this big 10x, 10 times goal. Is there a big goal you can hit out there that will increase the revenue of your company or whatever it is by 10 times, not just incrementally grown by 5%? Is there a big one? Is there a big thing there? Because that big opportunity, if we're not looking for it, we won't see it. And the opportunity of a lifetime has to be grasped in the lifetime of the opportunity. So there be the five reviews, and that's embedded in the culture. Because long after I've left, I want the company to be independent, to have the culture, to grow from strength to strength. And it's been working very well with the companies.
like if you look at Altec, which is one of the companies that you've worked with as well, and your partner as well, who passed away earlier in this year, that company evolves around the green platform.
Oh, absolutely. I worked with Altec from 1997, met Dr. Pierce Lyons 2002, and over the years got to know him very well. He became a very good friend, and we ran for thousands of hours in the morning in Lexington, in Bangkok, in Brazil, and in Hamburg, different places around the world. And we had these great chats in the morning, but he was an extremely positive man, and he was always looking for opportunities. And like, he did an interview in the States, and the interviewer asked him, what was the company about? Because he took the company, started with $10,000, 1977, built it up to over $3 billion now, with 6,500 people around the world. And he said it was never about making money. It was always about making a difference. And he said that, I remember him saying to one, like, Intel is inside in there. We have Green Platform inside. So when I was writing the second book, I had the second book finished, Living the Green Platform, Life-Changing Stories. And I was going down to a football match in Cavan, and I popped into McDonald's to get Wi-Fi, and I sent him an email and asked, Pierce, would you like to write the foreword to the second book, you know? And I thought, he has so many people, he's up to his ear, he won't have time for this. Instantly, he called me back and said, it would be my privilege, it would be my honour. And he wrote the foreword to the second book. And he said that the Green Platform has been integral to the growth and development of Altec over the years. But he lives it. He lived it like, you asked me, Joe, the other day about business advice, best business advice I got. Listening to him and working with him, he was a great salesman who was not concerned about sales. Mm. He'd meet somebody, he'd meet a customer, and he'd just say, it was all about them. What's your dream? Now, how can I help you achieve it?
Yeah.
And if he couldn't help, he didn't go there. And he said to me, I said a bit of advice from him, and he said to me, go where you're celebrated, not where you're tolerated.
Yeah.
And he said, it's all about, you know, working with people who believe in your vision and hiring people who believe in your vision. You don't hire people who need jobs, he said. You can get jobs anywhere. But you hire people who have a passion, who have a vision. And at his eulogy, Mark was saying to me, his son, Mark said, what are the three things that would sum up Dad, you know? And I said, that's easy, because over all the years, I heard it over and over. Number one, live with passion. Number two, commit to excellence. Excellent, and number three, have fun.
Yeah, and I live by them.
Yeah, you know, he could bring it down to that. And that's why he was such a magnetic person, and why even in Kentucky today, the 22nd of April is the day that he came to Kentucky, and that's in the state now, Dr. Pierce Lyons Day in Kentucky. Wow. They've given the day, and they spent 5 minutes in the United States Congress talking about the contribution he had made.
Wow.
But a huge man, but very, very positive, pure green platform.
Brilliant. We're coming to the end of the show. I could sit here all day. What book, apart from your own, would you recommend for people to read?
The one that made the biggest difference in my life has to be Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor Frankl.
Okay.
It was how he survived in Auschwitz. And he said to me, I was happy every day in Auschwitz. They killed 39 members of my family. They tortured me. They broke my body. They did operations on my genitals. But I was happy every day in Auschwitz because I made that choice every morning. That is the last and the greatest of the human freedoms, to choose your response in any given set of circumstances. So each morning, I made a choice to be happy. I made a choice to bring my best self into the day and to be the best that I could be for the others around me. And he said, I had this vision of seeing myself on the stage of the world, telling people that this should never happen again. And he said, give me a why and you can go through anyhow. If you have a purpose, a passion, a meaning, you will survive anything.
True. Where can people find the book, The Green Platform?
As they say in most good bookshops, but on thegreenplatform.com.
They'll get
the two books.
And you're on Twitter and Facebook and LinkedIn and everything.
Twitter,
as well.
Facebook, LinkedIn.
If anyone picks up the book, the goal settings is laid out as well that people can follow and use them to achieve their goals as well on it.
And there's one final thing, Joe, I'd like to say is that we have a special needs child, Alexander, at home, who has Maud Wilson syndrome, which means he'll never talk, he won't walk until he's about 14. He's taking some steps now. He's doubly incontinent. He's tube fed. And he is prone to seizures, a huge amount of problems. But the Jack and Jill Foundation and St. Catherine's special needs school were very good to him. So all of the profits we get from the Green Platform goes to the Jack and Jill Foundation and St. Catherine's Special Needs School.
Oh, brilliant. That's lovely. Yeah. Honor.
Just as it, because it's just they're so good and you want to give something back. So the Green Platform, if it is to be positive, it is to make a difference, it has to make a difference.
There's people all over the world that have it and, you know, live by it and everything as well. So it's a hidden little gem. It really is. Tell me, before we go, two questions. One is, what song would you like us to play out with, Declan?
The song is just very simple, to dream the impossible dream.
What's your definition of happiness?
My definition of happiness is, I feel the purpose of life is to be happy. And the only way I know to be happy is to make somebody else's life a little bit better. And I find happiness comes in, it's as you gradually heading towards a goal, you're achieving it step by step. But the goal is to make a difference in somebody else's life. And to me, me is the soul song of sadness. But you is the soul song of joy. So how can I help you have a better day? And the minute I move outside of myself, then all the joy and magic comes in the back door.
Beautiful. Declan Coyle, thank you for coming on Bray 2 Brands.
Thank you, Joe. My privilege.
To dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love pure and chaste from afar, to try when your arms are too weary, the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star. No matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest.
You and I know we can always do better. Breakthrough Brands Sales Acceleration Specialists, helping companies reach peak performance by introducing a marketing strategy to build a better prospect pipeline. Develop your leadership and sales skills with Breakthrough Brands Custom Sales Training Development. Go to Breakthrough Brands at www.jdc.ie or click the link on this page to see if Breakthrough Brands and you can work together. Great companies build a great relationship with their clients. Sales and marketing starts with a story. Let us help you with yours. Breakthrough Brands.